A student studying information technology at a college is examined by coursework and written examination. Both components of assessment carry a maximum of 50 marks. The following are used by examiners in order to pass. One, a student must score a total of 40% or more in order to pass. A total of 39% is moderated to 40%. Then each component must be passed with a minimum of 15. If a student scores 40% or more, but does not achieve the minimum in either of the components, he or she is given a technical fail of 39%. This mark is not moderated to 40%. Then number four, grades are awarded on marks for both components. Output the final marks and grade after any moderations. Then there is a grading system. You are required to write a program to input the marks for both components, output the final mark and grade after any moderations. Okay. Yeah, and then there's a requirement that you make use of functions. So I'm going to open my editor so that we can try to go through that. I hope my screen is visible. So I'm going to open Dev C++. Okay, so I had started writing the code. Okay, yeah, so from the instructions, I think we can be able to capture three functions. Okay. One of the functions will be the one for capturing the input. Just try to organize them. Going to increase the font and be more visible, make it 20. I hope that font size is good enough. We can increase it a little bit more. Get 26. Yeah, so let me just arrange these in some order. So I have these three functions, and those are my prototypes. Okay, there is a first function for inputting or for validating the user input to make sure that it's within the range. Then there is another function here for moderating the marks. And then finally, there is a function for grading. Okay. You could have more functions if you want. You could even have a function for the output. Okay, but you don't have to do that at the moment. You can leave it as that. Then we'll start by creating these functions. So for the input, it's supposed to check. Remember, it's reading user input. So we are using a do while loop in this case. Okay, we are using a do while. Remember, like I think we mentioned that the do while is different from the while loop. Okay, yeah. So that at least it allows the user to enter first before we can even check, before we can check whether it's within the range. Okay. Yeah, so if you use the while loop, that means it will check the read even when the user has not even inputted anything, okay, which is not what we are hoping to achieve here. So that's why I went for a do while. Okay, yeah. So remember, we'll ask for the input from our main. We'll ask for the input from our main function. Then now for the input function, the work that it will be doing will be checking whether whatever the user has entered is within the range. If it's not, it will output these. It will use now this. We'll have these new message here. We'll have this message to ask the user to try again. Hope we are together there. I'm quite sure most by now we know how this if works and also how the loops work. Okay, so the reason why I decided to use the input function is because if you don't use a function, that means you'll find that yourself you'll be repeating the same thing in your main function. Think you can try if you remember how your code was. For example, let's say the code for Kevin, you'll find that he was doing the do while for the coursework. He was also doing the do while for the exam. But now if we can do the we can create a function, we only need to call it twice. Okay, so that at least that one will reduce our code by a half. Okay, that will reduce our code by half. So that's why I have decided to use a function. But it was not compulsory for you to use it. Yeah, and so this is what it does. It checks whether if the value is less than 0 or greater than 50, then it will output an error message out of range. And then it will give the user an opportunity to try again. Yeah, so that now the value will be read during the next now iteration. So our input function is ready. Then now we have the moderation. Yeah, the one for moderating the marks, okay, which is supposed to take now both components, both the exam and the coursework. Okay. Then it will check if total is equals to 39, then we moderate it to 40. Okay. Then now, if maybe coursework is less than 15, or either the exam is less than 15, maybe we can use another function here, because for us to be able to check this, the total must be greater than 40. Okay, so we can start with that. If total if total is greater or equal to 40, and so we have this part which is being combined by the output of this one. Just hope that one will work. So that means if this is true, and either of this is true, then the total will be 39. So that means even if I got the exam 50, and then now the coursework I only got 10, the total mark will still be 39. But check that we are moderating the 39 before. Before here, so that we don't end up, because now this one is not supposed to be moderated to 40 again. And I think with that, we'll have moderated our marks. I think from the instructions. From the instructions, I think the marks will be moderated from by that now. Since we are saying now each component must be passed with a minimum of 15. If a student scores 40% or more, but does not achieve the minimum in either, he or she is given a technical fail of 39%. This mark is not moderated to 40. hope we are together there. Then now finally we are going to create our grading now system. The reason also why I have chosen to use a function for grading, it's because we are required from the instructions here. As you can see from the instructions here, we are told that grades are awarded on marks for both components and also the final mark. So that means we are going to grade three times. If we don't use our function, then that means you repeat the grading three times. So now to reduce our code, that's why I've decided to make use of a function now. And the grading system will follow this function. Okay. And so I can do that. Let me just check the prototype here. Here's our prototype. I'll just copy it so that I continue with it down here. Now I'm going to use if else if to grade. Grade. The grade will just be a single character. A, B, C, and what have you. Okay, so then now we can do the grading. Can have if mark is greater or equal to 70, then the grade will be equal to A. Else, if, I think we can copy this so that we don't have to do a lot of typing here. So this one will be 60, greater or equal to 60, where the grade will be B. Then greater or equal to 50, the grade will be C. Then greater or equal to 40, the grade will be B. The grade will be B else. Else the grade will be B. I think that's how it's supposed to be. Oh, it's F. It should be F here, not E. And now what we return is we return the grade now. Return that card. I hope we are together up to that point. So now our functions are ready now. We just need to call them in from our main function. Okay. Hope you are following. So in our main function, how many variables do we need? Can have three integers. For the coursework, exam, and the total. And you can have the grade character as a character. Okay. Then we'll have, maybe we can even print a welcome message to start with. can use tabs to align this center. We don't need these ones here. Then we'll have printf. Enter. Coursework. Then here we'll have CW. Is equals to, we call our input function. Then now next, printf. Enter. Exam. Mark. And even put the range here, just to make it more user friendly. So here now to read whatever the user has entered, we also call the input function. So then from there now to find the total, our total will get it from moderation. Total is equals to moderate. Then we pass CW and EX. Okay. Now after moderating, we grade. Supposed to grade, but now for grade we just need to output it. Just need to output it. So we can have printf. Crosswalk, grade, crosswalk, mark. And then you'll have a percentage D, new line. Actually, I can just have the grid, don't have to output the crosswalk grid. Then you'll have your percentage C, comma. Then we'll have grading. And then we pass the CW, pass the coursework. So we expect now when we call the grading, it will return a character which we'll print there as a grid. Okay. Then now printf. Exam. Grade. Then we'll have percentage C. Hope you are following. Then we'll call grading here. Then in this time we'll pass exe, the exam mark. And finally now we want to print F, now the final mark. Eh? Means to print off a final mark. Simply. New line, and then we call. Okay, we already have the total. We already call moderate. Then finally, we need now to output the comment here, because you can see if I go back to the instructions, it says that a student must score 40% or more in order to pass, so that we must output that whether the student passed or not. So we'll have now if, oh, we also need to output the final grade. Let me just output the final grade, printf. final grade. Percentage D, new line. Also here we call our grading system. This time round we pass the total. And then now we have to put the comment if total is greater or equal to 40, then I will output printf comment passed. Then you'll have press if total is equals to 39, this one will be a technical fail. Else will print the failed. Okay, and I think with that now, our program should be complete. We only need now to return 0 to terminate our main function.
Excuse, sir.
Yes.
What about the statement that is saying each component must be passed with a minimum of 15?
So now that's where we use the grade, we use the moderate function here. You can see here we are checking whether CW is less than 15. CW is the coursework. All the exam is less than 15.
All right.
So if 8 of these is less than 15, then it will end up with a technical fail.
Of 39.
Of 39, yeah.
All right.
So now we have written our source code, but we have not compiled it. So let's compile and see that it has errors and then we'll remove them. Okay, there are a number of errors. Oh, I didn't include the STDIO on top here. I need the preprocessor command. dio.h. We can compile again.
You haven't included the hash. Include.
Thank you for that. Thank you for that, Kevin. So I think it should be okay now, right? Let me compile again and see. Are good. Zero errors, zero warnings. Now it has passed, so there are no compile time errors. So now we need to check the runtime errors. And the runtime errors, we should check to make sure that it passes the specification. It's doing everything that it's supposed to do. I think I'm going to use a magnifier here. So now when we run this, the interface now that we get, what if I put a value like 55? I want to see whether you have to supply the wrong values when you're testing your programs to be sure whether it's really working. Okay, they'll tell me out of range, try again. What if I put negative 10? They still tell me out of range, try again. So until I put a variable value. Since I want to test my moderation function, I'll put a value that is less than 15. I'll give it a 14 for the coursework. Then exam mark, I'll give it even 40, so that, to make sure that the total is more than 40. Okay, and we see that's the output we get. Okay, for the coursework grade, it was an F, since it's below 40. The exam grade, it's a D. So I think, but there is a problem there, don't you think so?
Yes, there is a problem.
Because now we graded out of 50 instead of making it a percentage, isn't it?
Yeah. And also, it have commented pass, and you had a 14.
And it was supposed to be a technical fail, right? Yeah, so we are going to check that now. We are going to make changes to our program to remove those errors. The first one we'll remove is the one for grading. Let me just close the magnifier. It's making my screen hard to navigate. So now for the one that it's grading the coursework the wrong way, that one is not a problem because we only need to multiply it by two when we are passing here. Just need to multiply by two to make it out of 100. Okay. The same case with the exam. But now since the total is okay, for total we don't need to multiply anything because it's already out of 100. Then now we need to check our moderation function. Okay, so I think where the problem is coming in is here. Because I really had also doubts on my condition here. I don't know whether it's really working correctly. I don't know how we could do it to make sure that our... Maybe we could use a nested if. What if we use a nested if instead of an if else if? If we have it like this, if total is greater than 40, then we'll use this one. Then inside here, we'll have another if. Now we are checking this now. Just cut the whole of this one. Let's put it there. In this case, I have used a nested if instead of leaving it the way it was, so that it will first make sure that the total is greater than 40. I mean, it's greater or equal to 40 before even it checks whether the components. Okay. Yeah. I think this one should work now. So we can try again. Click on compile and run. I'll use a magnifier so that you can be able to see my output. So I'll do the same again. Since it has already passed the validation, we don't need to do that again. 14, and then give this one a 40, the same input you had given earlier. Okay. So, and I think that one now, while it's still not giving us the correct output, at least for the grading, it says, why is it giving me the final grade as 67 instead of the final mark? Oh, actually, it's correct. So we have the final coursework grade is F. The exam grade is A, which is true. The final mark is 54. And the final grade is 67, which is not correct. So that means we still need to check that condition again. We'll close the magnifier so that you can be able to navigate around. So you can check maybe up here inside the main function. You can see where so that you can see where the problem is. So what do you think could be the problem here? Well, I think I've noticed where the problem is. We didn't give, we didn't, we don't have a return. We don't have a return statement in this function. Hope you can all notice that, because for according to the prototype, you're supposed to return an integer, but we never returned anything here. We'll have to return. We'll have to return total there. So I think most probably even our initial condition was correct. The only problem was this particular any statement that we were missing in that function. So now I think we can try again. So I'm going to supply the same values, 14 and 40. And I think now it works. Okay. Yeah. And see, it's giving us the coursework grade is F, exam grade is A, final mark is 39, final grade is 70. Oh, I don't know how final grade is 70, it's supposed to be. Supposed to be a character. So you can always check that. I think the problem is here. We put percentage T here instead of C, since the grid is supposed to be a character. So I can't put a C there. And to give it a 14 and a 40 again. And I think now it gives us the correct in output. But there is another condition that you are supposed to test. What if the total is 39? We want to see whether it will be able to moderate it to 40. So most probably we can give one component 19 and the other one 20, so that it can see whether it will to moderate that. So I can give coursework 19 and the exam 20. Yeah. I think at least it moderates it to 40. Hope you are okay with that. I think we are now contented that our project, our program has passed the tests. Hope we are all okay with that. Ahmed, are you okay with that program and Weston? Ahmed, are you there? Can also see Weston. So now I want us to look at data structures. And before we look at data structures, we're going to look at pointers. We're going to look at pointers first. Okay. And so what are pointers? Okay. So far we have already looked at variables. And we say that variables are named memory locations. Okay. So now, but as opposed to variables, a pointer is also a variable, but now it doesn't store a value. It stores the address. Okay? It stores the address in memory of where a variable or a value is stored. Okay, and we're going to see that practically. I think I'm going to set this aside, and then I'm going to create another source file. And I'm going to save this. Call it pointers. Let's see. So I'm going to demonstrate now how pointers work. So now when you're declaring a variable, for example, if I wanted to declare a variable like n, I would have it as int n. But now a pointer variable, as opposed to the other normal variable, a pointer variable is supposed to start with an asterisk. Okay, so just before the variable name, you put an asterisk in the case of now a pointer. So now that makes the whole difference. That small asterisk there makes the whole difference. Can I have even another pointer variable like m. Then let's say now we add another variable. Now you're calling up p. Okay, so now let's say I say now n is equal to ampersand p. Okay, so when you put an ampersand before a variable name, it means the address of that variable. Just a second, check something. Yeah, so that's it. Is it? Yeah, so in the same way, if you wanted now to access the address stored, the value stored in a pointer, we have to start it with the asterisk. Okay, so for example, if I wrote q is equals to asterisk n. Now it will give me the value now stored in that particular pointer. So now if I was to print f, if I was to do a print f, I want to see what will be outputted by the value now held in n. Okay, I think you can be able to see it's printing some long number here, which is an address in memory. Okay, this is an address in memory. Okay, and so that one now tells us what now pointers store. Okay, pointers, in this case, n was a pointer, it declared n as a pointer. Then we assigned it the address of p. Yes, so it's now this is what it will be storing. Now, what if we printed f? Let's see now how we assign a p some value. Want us to see maybe what it will print. so that maybe we can see whether you can, from the examples, you can be able to clearly see the difference. Huh? You can also print it down here. Just put a new line. So down here, you can print F now here. Okay, and you can be able to see now. So for PH100, this one gives us an address in memory, and this one gives us the value again. Okay, so what does that mean? To get the value stored in a pointer variable, you have to start the pointer. You have to start the pointer with an asterisk. If you start it with an asterisk, then it will give you the value stored in that particular pointer. Then there is a we can have a pointer arithmetic, okay? You can do some few arithmetic on pointers, okay? So remember, one thing you need to keep in mind is a pointer is it's not a value, it's an address, okay? Yeah, so that means if, for example, if we incremented an address by one, a pointer by one, what happens? That means it will be pointing at the next instruction. It will be pointing at the next address. For example, if we repeated this one, yeah. Remember, this is our pointer. I just want us to increment our pointer here by n. Increment our pointer by n, and so that we can see what will be the difference now in output between these two. If we can remove these ones at the moment, can be able to see the difference. What happens when we increment our pointer? It looks the same. Maybe we can increment it outside. Yeah, and you'll see now it has incremented. Okay. It has incremented by 4 positions. So that means the next address from 10, it's 14. Anyone with a question on that? So now if we decrement a pointer, that means it will decrease the address such that it will now be pointing at the previous address. We copy this, and here instead of plus plus, put minus minus. So that means we are decrementing the pointer. You see now it will decrease the bytes by 4. Okay, yeah, so you'll see now it has gone back. it has come from a So initially, before we incremented, it was 2Fe10. We decremented by 1, it went to 2Fe14. We decrement again by 1, it goes to Fe10. So that means it goes back where it was. So every time we increment a pointer, just know that we are pointing to the next address in memory. We are pointing at the next address. We are together on that. Anyone with a question on pointers so far? Does it make sense? So now we can try to see now how we pass values. We can now try to understand now pass by reference. Okay. And for that, in that case, I'll try to create a function here, a very small function for swapping two values. Allow void swap. So now to pass by reference, here we'll have pointers. Instead of having the normal variables as our parameters, we'll have the pointers here. Let's say we have x and int y. Okay. So this is a function now we are creating. Just going to remove everything here.
I have a question.
Yes.
Why would we require addresses?
How do you require addresses?
Yeah.
That's what now we want to look at. Okay, the reason why we might need addresses, one more, what you are calling pass by reference is, in the case where you want, for example, we know that when you pass by a value, the only thing you are doing is you are copying the value to the function. But if what you are doing is, you can try to think of it this way. Let's say I had a file in documents. Okay. But to make it accessible, I need to create a shortcut on the desktop. Okay. So now I create a shortcut of the document on the desktop. Okay. So I want you to think this way. What will happen if I edit the document? Will the shortcut show the differences?
No.
It will not. Are you sure?
Yeah.
If I edit now the main document, will the shortcut now, when I open my document now from the desktop, will I see the differences if the one on the desktop was a shortcut?
If the one on the desktop.
Yeah, if the one on the desktop is a shortcut. So you'll find that if I change the main document, the shortcut changes. Cindy, if I change the shortcut, the document also changes because they are linked, because they are referring to the same thing. It's the same thing, just that you are accessing them from a different position. So it's the same case with pointers. If you pass a pointer to a function, it means you are passing the address. It's like you are creating a shortcut. So if I modify that variable inside the function, even the original one will still change. Okay. That's a good thing.
Okay.
Yeah. So I think we can, I can demonstrate that here so that we can see. So now let me put my function, my swap function down here. Then I love, I want to interchange the value so that the value that will be held in y will be in x and the other way around. So I love temp is equals to x. Then I think you can, you should take note of how I'm doing it here. This is a normal variable. Okay. So now to assign it to the value that is in x, I love to use the asterisk. So when you put an asterisk before a pointer variable, instead of returning an address now, it returns the value stored in that address. The same way an ambassador returns the address stored in a, the address of a certain value. It's just interchanging. So I have my function there. I have my, I've created my swap function there. So now inside my main function, I'm going to also have tengeneza variables mbili pia, one I and the other one j. Then I give them some values like 10 and j, I give it a value like 20. Then I'm going to call my swap function. So in this case, remember, since the swap function accepts pointers, it doesn't accept values. In pointers, we have seen they're supposed to be addresses. So to access the address, which operator do I use? I use the ampersand. I, j. So you will put an ampersand before a normal variable, it becomes now an address, not a value. Okay. So now by this now is what you are calling now call by reference. As opposed to when we would have called a function this way without the ampersand. If you've called the function without the ampersand, then that one would call it call by value. You are passing the value. For call by reference, we are passing the address of. So now let's try to output our values. And see what we'll get. So I want us to see now what will be the output, bearing in mind that I is 10 and J is 20. You can see it's giving us, let me just format the output here. It looks nice by putting a new line character. So now you can see the output here, it's giving us I is 20 and J is 10. But back in our mind, we know that I was supposed to be 10 and J. So that means the two values have been swapped inside the function. j is 10, but now from the output, it's giving us the other way around. Okay, so since we call this function, the values have been swapped. Okay, so I want us to look at a different version of the swap function, the one that doesn't have now, the one that is not using pointers. I'm going to remove all the asterisks. I'll call this swap one. So now we can be able to see the difference between pass by value and pass by reference. I'll make sure also I include the prototype on top there. So then here, I'm going to call the same function, swap. And pass I and j. And I'll also have the same outputs here. Hope you are following. So in this case, I expect, since here we are swapping the values, Cindy. So that I mean, that means I expect here it should return what? 10 and 20. Let's see what we get. We can maybe, yeah, let's see that. Now you can see in the first function, the values were not swapped. But in the second, they were swapped. So what does that tell you? Okay. In pass by reference, when you're passing by reference, the original value, if you modify the value inside the function, then even the original changes, just like the shortcut thing. If you modify the value, even the original changes. But when you pass by value, that one is like copy-pasting. For example, if I copied a document from my document's location or from downloads, and then I paste it in desktop. Okay, so you'll find that if I change the document on the desktop, the one in downloads will not change because I just created a copy. Is that true? So now, that one, you can see now pass by value is like copy pasting. Pass by reference is creating a shortcut. Okay, so now in technical terms, what we can say is when you pass by a value by when you call a function by value, when you call a function by value, the original or the actual parameters are not affected. But when you pass by reference, if the formal parameters are changed, the actual parameters also change. Hope we are together there. Anyone with a question on that, on the difference between the pointers and the variables? Kevin, are you okay now?
Yeah, now I'm good.
Yeah, good. So now I want us to look at, to start now on data structures. Okay, and in data structures, the first, like I've told you, data structures is just a way of organizing data. And one way you can organize data is by use of what you call arrays. Okay, by use of what we are calling arrays. I think I can mention that, I can type that. Arrays. So what are arrays? Okay, so, and we can say that arrays is a group of homogeneous data under the same variable. Okay, yeah, and I think we can show you that. You can have int marks. Okay? So in a normal condition, these marks will store only one value. If you want to store it 10 values, you just put square brackets and put 10. So now that makes it a group of values of the same type. All of these variable now will store, it will store, this variable will store 10 values, all of them under, all of them of type int. Okay, yeah, so that's now what an array is, a group of homogeneous data under the same name. Homogeneous means the same type. Okay, homogeneous means the same type. So now, okay, so now from here now you can see that I've created a single variable that can store up to 10. Okay? Remember the values, it's not a must they be 10. They can be less than 10, but they cannot be more than 10. Okay, so that means I can be able to store marks for 10 students under one variable. Okay, but the question now goes, how do I access now the individual marks? To access the individual marks now, you use something you call an index. Okay, so each of these 10 marks, all of them will have an index starting from zero. Okay, the indexes start from zero, you need to note that. So for example, if you wanted the first mark, you have marks, then okay, sorry about that, at index zero, and this one I'll say this one is equals to 20. Okay. Then I can have marks at index one. This one will be equals to 30. Okay. I can continue that assigning the marks up to 9 now, since there are 10 values and the indexes are still starting at 0. So that means the indexes will go up to 9. Okay. I can go further and further and forth. Okay. But remember also, you can initialize an array when you create it, okay, by using the same way you can use also a square bracket to initialize an array when you create it here. Okay, Yeah, so remember one thing you need to note when you're declaring an array, you must specify this number here. You must specify the maximum number of values that that array can store. Okay, so in C you must specify that. Then now you can also try to look at something else concerning the arrays. How do you now, instead of having to assign the values like this, 0, or what you're calling traversing an array, you can easily use a for loop instead of going one by one. You can use a for loop. For example, here, let's say I wanted the user to enter. You can say printf. Well, I can say for, we just add an I here, declare a variable I for the control variable N. Now for N is equals to 0, N is less than 10, N. Plus, and I can ask the user to input. Enter mark. Then now I last scan F. Percentage B, comma. Then I save it in max I. I mean N. After all of our numbers and here. Okay, so now this is a small loop here. Will help me store all the values for the 10 items. Okay, yeah. So the same way I can also output the values that I have entered. Okay, yeah. So let's see how that works. I'm going to remove all these. So you can see now this one starts by asking me to enter mark 0, and enter 20, enter mark 1, 30, 40, 50, 70, 80, 90, 100, finally 110. Yeah, so that one, with the use of a for loop, I've been able to save the values, okay, to my loop, to my array, that easily. So now I think you understand how now arrays work up to that point. Okay, so now I can try to look at the different types of arrays. Okay, so the one that we have currently looked at, we usually call it a single dimension array. Okay. So we can have a two dimension array. We can also have a multidimensional array. Okay. Yeah. But now, before we even look at two-dimensional array, we can try to see now the relationship between arrays and pointers. Remember that you'll come to know that all the items of an array, they will be stored in contiguous, in what we are calling contiguous memory locations. Okay. That means they'll be following each other. Okay. So for example, if I add a pointer here, if I declared a pointer variable and call it p. So now I can be able to generate the first element in an array to the pointer by just mentioning the name of the array without the brackets. So now I can say now p is equal to max. So in this case now, p will be storing the first element in that array. Okay, so for example, if I was to let me say I printed out this one, printf. I'm going to change this one to 3. I think if my condition is not correct here, it should be less than 3. Okay. And you can see now here for the output, my pointer has outputted 20, which was the first element in my array. Okay, so if you allocate the pointer, if you assign the pointer the name of an array, then it will be pointing to the first. It will be pointing to the first element in that array. Okay, so you can see now this is one of the applications of pointers. Okay, yeah. So for example, here if I incremented this pointer. If I incremented this pointer by 1, or if I incremented it by 2, then it will be pointing at the last element in that array. Oh, I need to output so that you can see the difference. So I'm going to give it a value of 20, 30, and 40. Okay. And you'll see now, whatever will be updated here is 20 and 40. Okay, 20 which was the first value. Then I incremented my pointer by 2. So it will be pointing at now the third value, which is the last value. So that one understood. Now I want us to look at two dimension arrays. And you'll find that a multi-dimension array, or an array which has more than one dimension, is nothing but an array of an array. Okay. In this case, assume I'm teaching the two campuses of ZTEC. Okay. I'm teaching for the town campus and the main campus. Okay. Where in the main campus, I have a class for structured programming, and in town campus, I have a class for structured programming, and I want to store the marks. Okay, so I can have the first dimension to mean which campus, the second dimension to mean which student in that campus. Okay, so that means I have two dimensions. I think I can show you that. I have int mark, I've called it mark instead of marks. So I'll have the first dimension. This one will be mentioned. How many campuses do we have? We have two campuses. Then the second dimension, which is specified by another pair of square brackets, will now identify the number of students in those campuses. Okay, let's say I can see that I can have a maximum of 50 students in each class. So that this means I have two campuses, each with a maximum of 50 students. Okay, so now let's say I want to assign the marks to the first student in the first campus. How would I go about it? I would have mark the first campus. In this case, since the array starts at 0, I'll have the first campus which is at index 0. In that campus, the first student, which is at index 0. Okay. You wanted the 10th student in the first campus, then I would have it like that. Okay. And now I can be able to give them the mark, maybe, let's say 95. Okay. So now that's a difference. Okay. So a multidimensional array, or an array which is more than one dimension, is nothing but an array of an array. Okay, so in this case, how many students do you think I have in total from this mini, from this R here? If I have two campuses, each with 50 students, how many students do I have in total? Yes. So that means I'll have 100 students. Okay.
Hello.
What? Yes. That means I have now 100 students. So now to get the total number of values that you'll store in a dimension array, just multiply the dimensions. Okay. Yeah. So let's think of maybe a three-dimension array. So how will a three-dimension array look? So now for a three-dimension array, we'll have int m. Maybe I have two campuses. Each campus has three strings. Has three strings, and each stream has 50 students. So what do you think is the total number of marks or the total number of values that I can store in that particular variable. Joseph, what do you think is the total number of values I can store in M? Or Kevin, or Hamid.
Is it 500?
Where did you get, how did you obtain the 500?
Not assuming 500. 250.
Yeah, exactly. Is it 250?
Yeah, I took me the two, the first dimension times 50. Then I added 3 times 50.
Yeah, I think that's where I actually should be 300, right? Because now, remember when it was two dimension, we multiplied the dimensions. So in the three dimension, we also multiply all the dimensions. So instead of adding, it should be 2 times 3 times 50. So that should need now make it 300.
Yeah,
exactly. So now, whatever you used a pointer to point at these, let's now I add my pointer and then I assign it a value mark. Okay. So that pointer, if I can increment it 100 times, every time I increment it, it will be pointing at the next value in my array. Okay, so now if I the 51st time, this array will be pointing, this pointer will be pointing at, will be pointing at mark at the 51st time. We can do it down here. If I have P plus equals 51, then this one will be pointing at the value at mark. Maybe someone can assist me. Which values will I put in the first bracket if I incremented the pointer by 51? What will be the index of the value? Remember, in this array, we have two dimensions. Okay, so the first dimension, which is a maximum of 2, and the second dimension, which is a maximum of 50. Also note that the indexes are starting at 0. So for the first dimension, it will be 0, 1, 2, until 50. Then the 51st, I mean until 49. So the 50th time, it will now start at the second dimension, which is 1. So in this case, you'll find that the address of this one will be 1, 1, 0. Is that okay? Is it understandable there?
So for the first dimension where we have 2, so we are decrementing. So if we had included 2 here, when we go to the second, now it would be 1.
Yeah, because the indexes are this one is the quantity. We have 2, but the indexes are starting at 0. So from 0, you count 2, it will be 0, 1. Okay.
Yeah.
So if you add the 10 here, what will be the index of the 8th item? So it's very important to understand how those indexes work, eh? They don't start at the campus, the first student. Second campus, the first student. So I increment both by one. So it will be one, instead of 1 year, zero. Are you together?
No.
So now what about this one? We wanted to know, let's say I did a P plus equals 200. Which values will I put in my three brackets? What will be the index? I remember here the assigned my pointer to M. What do you think will be the index here? I know this one will be complex, eh? Because remember here, we start at the end here. So this one will have 50 for each class. So for, I mean for the whole campus, this one will be 3 times 50. Okay, so that means each campus has a total of 150 students. Okay, then the next one will be, the next campus will also be 150 students. So since here we are talking about 200, we already now know that the 200 student will be in the second campus. Okay, so in the second campus, since the first campus filled at 150, so the second campus starts at 151. So from 151 to 200, that one will be the first stream. 201 to 250 is the second stream, 251 to 300 is the third stream. So that means 200 will be, 200 will be in the first stream, then the 49 students. Actually, the first stream should be 049. So this one I can call it multi-dimensional.
Can you explain again?
So what I have said is, I want you to think of it now in a real world situation. Okay, we have ZTEC, which has two campuses, the town campus and the main campus. In each campus, we have three streams. Okay, and in each stream we have 50 students. So how many students are in each campus? How many students are in each campus? If the campus has three streams and each stream has 50 students.
150.
So that means we'll have, let me just put some, we'll have the first campus. So the first bracket represents the campus. So the first campus will be index zero. Yeah. So now in the first campus, you have three streams. So the first stream will be index zero. Okay. So for this stream to be full, it will go up to 49. Okay. And by the time we reach 49, that means we'll have come across how many student, 50 students, since we are counting from zero. So that means from the 51st student, we'll have jumped into the second stream. Okay, so now the second stream will go all the way up to 99, which is now 49. So now from 101, we'll have jumped in the third stream. So this one will be 2. So the third stream now will go all the way to 49. So that means in three streams, we'll have filled that campus. So that means from here, we'll have to jump now to the next campus. So the first student in the first stream, I mean the second campus, the first stream, the first student will be like that. Okay, the first student in the second stream in the second campus will be that. Then the first student in the third stream in the second campus will be that. So now that's how we work with arrays. Are you together then?
Yeah.
So that's now you count. You start counting from the stream. You start counting from this last bracket. Ikija, una increment here, pili. Here, pili ikija, una increment here, tatu. Okay. And so maybe I can remove the multi-dimension. We first start by looking at the two dimension. So now, how do we navigate a two dimension array? The same way we use for one dimension, we are using a for loop. So for two dimension, we'll also use a for loop, but in this case, it will be a nested for loop. I think I can show you that. We are going to have int. Then let me have int. Which values have we not? Then I have g and h. These are my loop control variables because I have two nested loops. Then I'll have here for I. In this case, assume now it's only one campus, but with two streams. It's two streams where each stream has 50 students. So I'll start by going to the first stream. If I want to count, I'll start by going to the first stream. I'll go I is equal to 0, I is less than 2, I plus plus. So now I'm inside the first stream in my campus. So I start counting now the students. So I'll have 4. Okay. I don't know why I'm using I here. That should be G and H. H. Now remember, I'm counting the students in the stream. So I'll start again at 0. Now, since it can hold a maximum of 50, they'll go H is less than 50. H. Plus plus. Then now I can ask the student to, I can ask the user to enter printf. Enter mark for student. For student percentage D in stream. Stream percentage D. Then now I'll have G and H. I think it's the other way around. Enter mark for student H. G stream. Then now I'll scan F. Percentage D, comma, mark G H. I know this one is getting a little bit complex, but I'm quite sure with practice, you'll be able to understand. So in this, I'm going to remove the unnecessary. Since you have all understood about one dimension, I'm going to remove all of these. So that now that's our, we'll have a variable there. Can put these ones here. X, put it here. We can have int and declare our pointer variable there. Okay, so now that's how it works. So that means we have a nested for loop here. So this inner loop, it will execute how many times? 50 times, then it will exit. After it terminates, the outer loop now will go to the second iteration. It will go to the inner loop again and execute 50 times. And then it will exit. And it goes to check outside again, it will find that the outer loop also exited. So now I can reduce the number for these ones so that we can be able to test how this one works now. Then I can try also to test my pointer. See where my pointer will give me the expected output. So in this case, I'm expecting 10 values. So let's say I want my pointer to give me the 10th value. So I'm going to increment it by, if I want it to give me the 9th value. Then I can print F. So now I can try this and so that you can see how now it works out. Mm-hmm. Have an error there. Assignment from incompatible pointer type.
I think the problem is,
yeah,
you have used G and I at the same time.
Oh, thank you so much for that. All of them should be G. Thank you. Okay, so now you can see it's telling me enter mark for student 0 in stream 0. Let's say I enter 20. There is a runtime error there. I didn't put an ampersand here. And now you can see that it will tell me enter mark for student 1 in stream 0. So we are still in stream 0. 30. Second student in stream 0 still, stream 0 still, and finally stream 0 still. And now next we'll go to stream 1. So that's why it's telling me enter mark for student 0 in stream 1 now. So I can also give them the same marks. Okay, let me just continue and have 80, 90, 100, and 1. And we'll see now, my pointer is giving me, it's outputting 110, since I incremented 8 by 9. So that means it will be pointing at the 10th value. Hope now it's understandable. So now that's how you traverse a two-dimension array by using nested for loop. The inner one is for this. The outer one is for the first dimension. So if I add three dimension, how would it be? Kevin, what do you think if I had three dimension and I want to traverse? How many nested for loops would I have?
Three.
Would I have nested for loop, three nested for loops? For example, if it was, let me just try it. Let's say I add another one here. Let me add another dimension here, two. Okay, if I add it that way, then I would have maybe G. Add F. I'd have another for loop here. For F is equals to zero. F is less than two. F plus plus. So this one is supposed to terminate down here. And then these ones now they should be identified, that you can see who is inside who. Okay, so now you can see now you have the inner loop, which is inside this loop, and this loop is inside this loop. Okay. Such that now here would have marks F, G, H. Are you together now on arrays?
Yeah.
Anyone with any concern? So if no one has a problem now, the next thing we'll be looking in our second lesson is how now we can pass arrays to functions. How do we pass arrays into functions? And now you'll find that the pointers play a very big role in that situation. Okay, yeah, so for today we'll end it there. I'll give you an assignment that you'll do before the next lesson on arrays so that you can test yourself whether you understand that concept, you have understood the concept of arrays and end pointers. So I wish you all a nice evening.
You too.